First of all, it's a pleasure to have you here with us. And I read a lot of your books. So your stories, and it's wonderful stories, amazing inspiration, big imagination. So I want, the first question is, what was your inspiration, the imagination to make these kind of stories?
Well, I was really lucky. I used to work for a publisher. I was an editor. I never intended to be a writer at all. I loved reading, and as a child, I grew up, you know, just reading all the time. I used to get told off at school for actually reading too much. And I worked with some amazing authors while I was in publishing. And I didn't realise that what I was doing as I was working as an editor was actually training myself to write. And then I came up with an idea for a book that actually I was supposed to suggest to an author. It was to say, you know, we've got this great idea, we'd really like someone to write it. But I fell in love with it myself. I worked on it for a while, and I just couldn't bear the idea of giving it to somebody else to write. So I wrote it myself without telling anybody what I was doing. And when I'd finished, I did actually have to admit to all my colleagues that I'd written this book. And looking back on it, I find it really hard to believe that I did it, because I'm not a very daring person. It was quite a big risk to take to do this. But I think just having grown up surrounded by stories and books and spent so long working with authors, it was just something that was gradually seeping into me. And from then on, I think I've probably been inspired by often by real life events. So I've always owned lots of animals, and I love writing about animals and writing about people's relationship with animals as well. So yeah, a lot of luck has come into things really as well.
The house of the family home, I mean, it's a great series. Three books so far.
Yeah, I finished the fourth one, but it's not published yet.
Right. So tell us about this series. I mean, what's so special about the relationship between the girl and the dog, and the events that they're facing and the challenges they're having?
Well, I love the way that the sense of history and the sense of place can come through a book. And sometimes some of my favourite authors are people who can make you feel a place as well as a character. And I really wanted to try and create a setting that would really be part of the story, that would influence the story. And so when Polly goes to her home, she feels that it's special. And I wanted the readers to feel that with her too. And I love the idea that all of the dogs who've ever lived in the house, it's such a special place that they stay, that their spirits stay behind after they've gone, and that they come out and play with her. That was something that I came up with the idea walking to go fetch my children from school. I think lots of ideas came together in the story, but the idea that all the dogs were still there, they were in the paintings and in the statues, in parts of the carving, the wooden carvings around the building. That was just something that came into my head as I was walking, and I knew that I had to write it.
Your other story, the second, like the Secret Garden.
Yeah.
It's a very interesting story. It's been adapted to many series and TV shows. So, what was your inspiration for this story?
When I was saying that I love the way some authors can create a sense of place, my absolute favourite author of that is Francis Hodgson Burnett, who wrote The Secret Garden, because Mrs. Lake Manor, the house that she created, is just, it's incredible. The building and the stories and the way that the stories are still haunting the present from so many years before. It's fascinating, and it's a bit ghostly, it's exciting, it's very sad. And I wanted to bring another character back to that house. And it was something that was actually suggested to me by an editor a good 5 years before I wrote it. And when she first mentioned it, I was sort of horrified at the idea. I couldn't imagine being so presumptuous as to go back to such a book that's had such a huge effect on me and so many other people. But the idea just kind of kept going in the back of my mind, and I loved writing it. So much so that I've written a sequel to another of her books as well, Little Princess, which is about suffragettes. And I really, yeah, it's something I've really enjoyed doing.
Your books have been translated to many languages through the world. What was your impression that your books being read by many people in the world?
It's so exciting. It's really, really exciting. I've been to a school while I've been in Dubai. It's lovely knowing that children are reading my books here. The funny thing is, I was talking to the children about a particular book which is set at winter in England, and it's snowing. And of course, that's something that never happens here, or in the top of the mountain, possibly. But so it's strange in a way that something that's almost so alien to be it, but it's still interesting and exciting. But then I love reading books about different places, so I think there's something we all share, which is the idea of stories and excitement and wanting to have adventures. And I think people all over the world more and more love animals and find that being with animals and also being in nature is incredibly refreshing and restoring, and there's something wonderful about building a relationship with an animal, and I think that's something that's worldwide, especially for children.
No challenge made stories for kids and children, the imagination and the concept. It's really interesting topic, but it's really amazing. So your career is amazing, and I really appreciate what you've done. So my question is, what's your advice, or what's your suggestion for your people who want to write children's stories in the new generation?
People who want to write children's stories, I mean. To be honest, I think you've just got to really, really want to do it, and if you persevere and you keep going, I don't think anyone's ambition should be to be published. I think it should be just that you want to write. When I had an idea that I loved, I couldn't give it to anybody else. I think you've got to feel like that. You've got to feel that you're the only person who can write that story, the only person who can give that story to other people. But getting published is very difficult, and it becomes more and more difficult. Even though more books are published than ever before now, it's still very hard for an author to start out. And I was lucky because I worked for a publisher, so I had a built-in advantage. But I think one thing that's very helpful is using social media to connect with other authors, and also with agents and publishers. But there are so many amazing stories out there that people want to be able to tell.
I agree with you, because a lot of writers say the same thing. I mean, it's nice to find a publisher for your stories, and you have to keep writing your idea and imagination, so you can have like a base of your ideas and stuff. So maybe in the future you find a publisher or some kind of.
I think also what really helps is if you can join some kind of writing groups, so that you're actually sharing your stories with other people and having feedback from people. Is, even though it's quite daunting, is really important to have somebody to help you crafting your skills. And through working in publishing, I had a lot of, without realising it, because I was looking at manuscripts and trying to improve, work out how authors could improve them, and working on structure and character development, it was almost like a training ground. I think that often a writing group can give that to people who are hoping to be published.
Thank you. Well, thank you very much for your time. Pleasure to meet you.
You too.
I wish you all the best.